Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to another Wednesday night prayer and praise experience meeting. You are tuned into FWP Center. That's the First Seventh-Day Adventist Church of White Plains. We welcome you. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We will start off with a word of prayer, and then we'll have a song, a special song after this. Let us pray. Dear loving Lord, we thank you so much for your wonderful words, your wonderful words of life to us, dear Lord. And we pray that you will be with us, continue to bless us with the good things that you have given to us. I pray that you will be with us as we congregate together, dear Lord, on this platform to worship and to praise you on this Wednesday night. Thank you so much for all those who are with us and those who will be joining us soon. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Great are you.
Welcome back. We just want to thank Shauna and the praise team for such a beautiful song or rendition for us tonight. We are heading into our prayer or intercessory prayer. We do hope that you will place your prayer request in the chat. If you haven't done so, just go ahead and put that into the chat. And if we happen to miss your prayer request, please remember that there are prayer warriors who will be praying on your behalf. We're going to head into prayer, but I'm going to just mention a few prayers that we can lift people up with. We're still praying for baby Maya. We have our church family who have also lost. We're praying for baby Maya, Elder Jackson, and those of or members who are on our sick and shut-in list. We're also praying for those who have lost loved ones. We have Sister Judith Johnson, who lost her mom, Sister Foster, who lost her son, and we're also praying for Sister Carolyn Clark Jenkins. She lost her husband recently, yesterday. We are praying for our seniors. We're also praying for our children and our young people, the leaders of our church as well. So we're going to do a prayer song, and then we'll have Elder Robert Webb, who will be doing our intercessory prayer. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Oh Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. The psalmist David encourages us this evening, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together." Friends, it is that moment in time again when we all can gather and dial into Jesus and know that not one person will hear a busy signal, because Jesus is on the main line right now, and we all need for him to hear, and he promised that he will answer. We have heard the requests that were mentioned previously, and if there are any other requests that you may have, feel free to write them in the chat. And if not now, but at another time, we'll certainly lift all of these requests up before our God. So in the spirit of prayerfulness and cheerfulness, why don't you bow your heads with me while I pray? Holy Father God, which art in heaven, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, your dear Son, our loving Savior, we bow ourselves right now and joyfully declare that you are our Father. We thank you so much, O God, that you, by your own power, strength, and might, has preserved and kept your people safely. You have been with us through the past days of this week, yea, even since the last time we assembled together on this platform in this fashion. Your presence has been with us. Your protective watch care has hovered over all of your dear children. We have been embraced and we have been surrounded by the presence of God. And here we are this evening glorifying the name of the Lord Jesus our God and claiming the precious promises that you have in store for your children. As we come, holy God, we have come not just with our petitions of askings before you, God, but we have come with a rejoicing in our hearts Not many people, God, as they think of their earthly father, can approach them in the attitude and with the manner with which we can approach you this evening. And so we just want to thank you, God, for making it possible. Thank you for the experience that awaits us now during this prayer of intercession. And Father God in heaven, as your eyes move back and forth throughout the earth, declaring that you are God, omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent, we humbly ask, oh God, that every soul will receive from God that blessing, that individual blessing that you have for each person. God, we would like to thank you for your great and marvelous love, one that embraces us from whatever direction we may come. One mighty God that lifts us from the doldrum of this life and places us in a position where we can be called sons and daughters of God. Amidst all the defilement of our bodies, we recognize this evening that we have a Savior whose blood never loses its power and is able to wash clean and make pure all those who come before him in sincerity. So I pray, God, that if there's a soul tonight that is void of sincerity, that is void of purity, that the Holy Spirit will take a hold of that mind, of that individual, and transform that mindset into one that is focused upon Jesus to receive of his hand the blessing he has in store. Father God in heaven, I pray at this moment that you would draw nigh to your children as we endeavor to draw nigh to you, recognizing that a life without Jesus Christ is no life at all, that amidst the difficulties and the perplexities of this life, as children of thine, we can rest in peace, knowing that the God of peace surrounds us, that the peace speaker stands ready to speak to the waves that rises up against us, makes our lives boisterous and hard to deal with. Father God in heaven, there is a soul tonight somewhere bent low beneath the load of their burdens and their cares, wondering if they would ever be released from this burden. Tonight, Holy God, let it be that it's a breakthrough for that individual. Tonight, let it be, mighty God, that every person, however their situation or circumstance in life may appear to be, will recognize that through this medium of prayer, they can approach God, their Father, and they can unload their burdens at his feet and rest and repose themselves in the love of Jesus. Oh God in heaven, tonight there's a heart that is crying out because it is pained and hurting. Because God, there is a disappointment. There is a discouragement. There is a hurt. There is a pain that only Jesus can feel with them. Oh, Father God in heaven, relying such a soul, I pray that you will show up and show yourself great and mighty in that person's life. That home where the shadows seem never to be lifted. Oh, God, descend, I pray, from heaven above, and fill that place with the atmosphere of heaven. Let people know that there is a peace that your Lord can give, a peace that the world cannot take away from them. Oh, Father God in heaven, and when the heart of your children are tempted to believe that Jesus is absent, remind them that Jesus cares. When the night seems dark and when the loneliness comes upon them, when it appears as if they are alone, remind them tonight, oh God, that you will walk with them through the valley of the shadow of death, and they need not fear no evil, for thou art with them. That young person who is searching for a deeper understanding of the love of God and his outreach to them, may they find you, God, and may you become to them like that pearl of great price. Then, Jesus, I pray that they will treasure every moment with Jesus, their Savior. To those who are in leadership, God, we pray this afternoon, this evening, that grace and might and power from on high will enshroud them, Jesus, and they will know, mighty God, that they themselves are but servants in the hand of our Heavenly Father. Therefore, God, whatever their decisions will be, grant that they will seek for divine wisdom so that they will know how they are to act and how they are to legislate, so that the hearts of God's children will not be made to be troubled or to wonder. Tonight I pray, Jesus, for our youth. Oh, Father God, that group of people today who feels abandoned, forsaken. That group of young people tonight, Jesus, who are looking for a better life. Oh, God, remind them that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man comes to the Father but by Jesus Christ. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear me and you would open your door, I will come in and I will sup with you and you with me. Give to that youth who is searching tonight that deliverance that they seek in terms of where to go, what to do, and how to lead their lives. Then, Father God, that mother and that father whose hearts are pained because of their wayward children, remind them this evening, God, that you too have seen your children wander away from you, but you never gave up hope that they would return. And so they themselves can look forward with hope that one of these days their wayward child or children would return and that there would be a great rejoicing together. Holy Father, the one whom you have laid hands upon to speak a word in such a time as this, may he himself, Jesus, be lifted up before you right now in prayer, and may you shape him. May you turn his mind. May you direct his thoughts, that his words that flows from his lips will be not his, but as a result of inspiration from the Holy Spirit. Hence, mighty God, the name of Jesus alone will be glorified, and the heart of every believer and every hearer would be blessed. Thank you that you are willing to hear all of our prayer requests tonight. Let none be disappointed, and in that glorious morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which remain and alive shall be caught up to meet them in the air, so that we can be with Jesus, our loving Savior, forever and ever. God, on that glorious day, may all of us on this platform and those who hear the word and will hear it again be part of those who will glorify your name. This we humbly pray in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Elder Webb, for praying on behalf of all our prayer requests and those who were in need of prayer. So now it's time for us to go into the Word. So I'm going to introduce the speaker for tonight. He is always smiling. He's a man of God, and he has been a great inspiration to me. Always has an encouraging word, and is very sociable with everyone he comes in contact with. So he's none other than Pastor Ivor Richardson. He's also an elder at our church. And before he comes to us, we will have a song of meditation. And after that, you will hear the voice of none other than Pastor Elder Ivor Richardson.
I'm wrong, no sound.
All right. I'm told that you guys are not hearing me. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. All right. Just before Pastor Richardson comes to us, we will have a scripture reading. Scripture reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 55, beginning at verse 1, and we will go down to verse 11. So if you have your Bibles, please follow with us. I'm reading from the New King James Version, or whatever version you have, you can still follow along. Isaiah 55, beginning at verse 1. The New King James Version has it as this. Oh, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, the sure mercies of David. Indeed, I have given him as a witness to the people, a leader and a commander for the people. Surely you shall call a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God and the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Verse 6, as we continue, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts, the Lord says in verse 8, are not your thoughts, nor are my ways, nor are your ways my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. And that again is Isaiah 55, verses 1 to 11. Over to you, Pastor Richardson.
Thank you so much, Elder Abaranger. I'm always blessed by the way you read. You read with such passion and clarity that I know it's a gift from God, and I thank God for you. That's why I really love when you read the scripture. Thank you so much. I want to thank our lovely host, Sister Abaranger. Sister Abaranger, I want you to know that when you said I'm always smiling, it caused me to bust out in a big grin. I'm doing it again. It reminds me of a teacher, because I just recently retired from teaching. It reminds me of a teacher that says, Mr. Richardson, you never fail to have a smile on your face, and you're always happy. And I had to tell her, yes, I'm a happy person. When you're the Lord Jesus Christ, you're happy. Christ makes you happy. And of course, I greet God's people. I love them all, because we're supposed to greet each other with a holy kiss and a hug. And I try to follow in that sentiment as much as I can. I pray for God's people. I love God's people. And so I'm equally thankful for the opportunity to speak to you tonight. I also want to thank Elder Robert Webb, who in his beautiful intercessory prayer, his powerful prayer, prayed for me that I may be able to speak the message boldly. I appreciate that so much. And thank you for praying for all of us. And thank you especially for praying for our youth. Our youth is a passion of mine. And I pray for our youth in the church, and of course, those outside in the community as well. Those in schools, they're getting ready to go back to school. And we have to remember to keep our young people in prayer. It's very, very, very important. And so I just thank God for the opportunity to speak to you tonight on the topic, the authority of God's word, the authority of God's word. Let us pray. God, in this brief preaching moment, humble our spirits, take away our worry, oh God, that we may be able to put down our burdens at the feet of Jesus. If we're smart, we leave them there because nobody knows how to solve our issues or problems better than the Lord Jesus Christ. But some of us will take our burden back up because we're stubborn. We believe in solving things by our own bootstrap. But those of us who are wise, those who are touched by the Spirit of God, know, leave and give and leave your problems to Jesus. So, Lord, I pray that you'll help us have teachable spirits tonight, that as your Spirit calms us down and opens up our understanding, the Holy Spirit may teach us what we need to know and help us to have our minds and soul open to you, that you may bless us, you may consecrate us, you may make us kingdom ready, so that, Lord, that when a word comes to us, we'll be able to accept it, and that, Lord, that you will mark us for your kingdom, seal us, give us that seal that says we are a child of God. Because no force, no devil, no demon, no evil force can undo that. And so help us to receive you, receive the Lord Jesus Christ as a Savior, that we might inherit eternal life. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the collective meditation, O God, of your people's hearts may be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and redeemer. Amen. And so I greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love you, and I pray for you often. The word that God has laid on my heart is the authority of the word of God. Now, I think we readily can accept that the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, and God the Father by extension, and God the Holy Spirit by extension, since they are connected, that they ought to be an authority in our life, especially if we consider ourselves a Christian, and one who is saved by God, one who's given his life to the Lord Jesus Christ, and allow the Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit, to be the head of our lives. And Isaiah is inspired, the prophet Isaiah is inspired to write in this beautiful passage, seek the Lord while he may be found. Do it early, do it often. But I like what he has in verse 11 about God's word. He says, so shall my word be that goes out of my mouth. It shall not return to me empty or void, as it says in the King James, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and succeed in the thing that for which I sent it. And so that tells me that God, through his word, knows how to reach you. God, in his word, knows how to find you. God, in his word, knows how to secure you. I want you to know that tonight. We can never escape the presence of God, even if we try. And don't think God does, you're so wretched that God doesn't know where to find you. God says that this word he sends out will reach you. This word which he sends out will what? Teach you. This word which he sends out will wash you of your sin and cause you to accept the Lord Jesus Christ so that you can be sanctified and saved. And so recognize that we serve a God that what? Has designed a word for you. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that a wonderful thing that we have a God that has so much compassion for us, so much love for us, that he knows where to find us through his word? I don't know about you, but that's the kind of God I like to serve. I don't like to serve a God do's and don't do this, don't do it. No. I serve a God who shines the law of liberty, who shines light, who sends a word to secure me. And I want you to know this word, Isaiah is saying tonight, that this word, when God sends it out, what God designed it to do, it will be done. And there's no devil, there's no demon, there's no demonic force that can stop that. When Christ was returning to God and spoke to his disciples in John 14, he says, if I don't go, I cannot send him. But if I go, I'll send him. I'll send you another advocate. This advocate will be none other than the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, the one who will not only guide and protect you, but the one who will teach you all things. And so God teaches us what we need to know through his word. And so if we don't receive the word of God, we're cheating ourselves. We're blocking our blessing. Because you must accept this word. The psalmist David, who God says was a man after his own heart, wrote something in scripture. He says, thy word I've hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. So knowing God's word and receiving God's word helps us to avoid sin in our lives. And as we accept Christ and we walk daily with Christ, one of our prayers should be, Lord, dry up within me the desire for sin. No, I'm not naive, and I know that we are up against a lot, especially with this pesky devil. And when God asks the devil, where have you been? He says, I've been busy going to and fro on the earth, seeking who I may devour. And so we know that the role of the devil, the deceiver, the enemy of our souls, is to deceive us and to make us a stumbling block. And so for those of us who don't receive God's word, those of us who don't read it, those of us who don't understand it and use it, we're at a deficit. We're leaving ourselves dangerously open to a devil that's seeking to what? Destroy us. And so the psalmist says, thy word have hid my heart that I might not sin against God. The scripture also tells us that God's word, we should not only read it and learn it, but we should write it on our foreheads. We should bind it around our lips, that the word ought to be absorbed in our lives. And we ought to know this word so well that we are able to share it with those around us. If we can't share a scripture with someone, how can we do evangelism? How can we win souls to Christ? Especially if we don't know this word ourselves. And so the prophets in the scripture are advising us to know God's word, to hide it in your heart, to write it on your forehead, to bind it around your lips, to know God's word in and out. And Isaiah tells us that God has sent this word to look for you. And whatever God designs his word for, it will come to pass. It will be accomplished. Paul in 2 Timothy tells us something about God's word. He's really talking to the young pastor, the young apostle, Timothy. You know, Paul loved Timothy very much because Timothy was very obedient and very open to Paul's teaching and leading. I remember one time he told Barnabas, I can't take you with me, because Barnabas wouldn't accept as readily what Paul was trying to convey to Timothy. And so, you know, he loved Timothy so much that Timothy would be installed by Paul as a young pastor in Ephesus. And so young Timothy found himself as the leader, the pastor, the apostle, the teacher of the Ephesians. And you know that the Ephesian church had a lot of problems because when God knocked Paul down on the road to Damascus and converted him, because you need to know, Paul lived a wretched life. Even though he knew the scripture and he was a member of the Sanhedrin, his job was to kill and persecute Christians. And so God said to him one day, he's walking the road together, not today, Paul, or Saul, as his name was then. God knocked him down, blinded him, have him stay in the way for 3 days while God worked on his conversion. And when he came through, God says, I know you want to go to the house of Israel, but no, I have ordained you and called you to teach the Gentiles. Paul was so effective in reaching the Gentiles, he brought so many Gentiles in to the Ephesian church, at Church of Ephesus, so rapidly that some of them came unconverted. They were doing witchcraft, serving Baal and other devilish gods. And this was Timothy's job. But there's something he tells Timothy in chapter 3 in verses 16 and 17. And he says to him, all scripture, all of God's word, all scripture is inspired by God, is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. And so we need to understand that reading God's word and knowing God's word equips us as saints to do the will of God, equips us as saints to ensure that God's will be done in our lives God will be done in the life of others, especially those of the community of faith, but also for those who don't yet believe. God's word is working on them. We are to be conduits that bring God's word to them. And so Paul, in his second letter to Timothy, tells Timothy, not just the scripture that are our favorite verses, not just the scripture that we know, but even the ones that we think we don't like, even the ones that are not as familiar to us, all of the scripture. And I know that theologians and other religious scholars argue that they're what? Faults in the Bible and things that are not right. But I don't believe that. I think all of God's word, whether you believe that it's influenced by the personalities and intellect of the prophets or apostles who wrote them, he's inspired to say that all of it together is good for training in righteousness. And so I hope you begin to see that just as the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, is an authority in our life, just as God the Father, by extension, is an authority in our life, just as the Holy Spirit is an authority in our life, so must the scriptures be, that God's word is an authority in your life. And so he's reminding Paul's reminding Timothy that all scripture has value. The psalmist David says something in Psalms 119 and verse 105. Let's turn to that. In Psalms 119, verse 105, he says this. The psalmist says this. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now, that is very, very significant. Because we live in a world that's full of what? Darkness. And as much as we're Christians who represent the Holy Spirit and represent what's good about Christ, and what is good about giving your life to Christ in the world, we still live in darkness. And so the Apostle John puts it this way. He says, a light shone into the darkness, and the darkness didn't overcome it. And if you don't understand the scripture, it's saying that when we were in our sins, groping around in the darkness, being deceived and bewildered by a devil, that Christ came and shone the light of Christ so that we can what? See our way to Christ. When Christ shined his light, the light caused us to see our sin and the need for a Savior. We're all in need of a Savior. No matter how saved you may be, you need to remember that you're a sinner, forgiven by grace, cleansed by the grace and righteousness of Christ, and washed up and anointed and set apart for God's use and glory. And so the psalmist is inspired to write that thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And so without the light of Christ, we're lost. Without the light of Christ, we're hopeless. Without the light of Christ, we're blinded. We can't see our way to God. And so Christ shines his light. There's something also significant about the word becoming a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. The scripture tells us that broad is the way that leads to destruction. Or it puts it this way. There's a way that seems right to man or woman, but the ways that the ends that are the ways of destruction. And I need to tell you tonight, don't get offended, but men and women, we like sin and destruction. Sounds absurd, doesn't it? But we leave ourselves open to a pesky devil that leads us sometimes to sinful places and sinful things. And God says, broad is that way that leads to destruction, and many they are that enter in. Another scripture says, fools enter where angels dare to tread. And so this way that leads to destruction is broad, is got beautiful light, music of the world, and then many who are just boogieing down and partying their way all the way to the end of this road, not realizing that they're going to doom, where they'll fall in a pit of destruction, may not even be able to get out. scripture also says something that is sobering. It says, narrow is the way that leads to God. And few, this is a troubling part for me, few there are that find it. That always burdens me and make my heart heavy, because I desire that everyone will find the Lord Jesus Christ for themselves, would give their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ, and would live a Christian life, Lord God, to anoint them, save them, forgive them, seal them, mark them. Which Christian doesn't want that? Which person in their right mind doesn't want that? That's how we earn eternal life. And it also says about this winding road, it's dark and it's stony. And if you're a country boy, or if you're a Caribbean person, you kind of know about stones, and that you may stump your toe against a stone. And sometimes when you stump your toe, you stump it so hard that the toe begins to what? Bleed. In America, we might not be cognizant of that because we have nicely paved roads. We don't have too many cobblestone roads anymore or stony roads anymore. And so we understand that stumping your toe can be serious business. Something have to have that binded and washed up and medical attention. But that's what happened. So this light that God gives us, this lamp that God gives us, help us to avoid dashing our toe against a stone. And what are the stones in our lives? It's not only the physical stone, but it's problems in our life that we can't overcome. They're painful, like when we stump our toe against a stone. And some of us, even though we should know better, allow sin to take place in our life. We won't repent. We won't ask God to forgive us. And so we suffer for a long time unnecessarily. And so God gives us the word, which is the lamp, which is the light, which helps us negotiate our part, which helps us walk to the end of that road and find the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you're a Christian tonight, you should know that the Lord Jesus Christ is your Savior. By extension, God the Father is your God. And by extension, God the Holy Spirit is your God. And they must be an authority in your life, and they must absolutely be the head of your life. You can't be a Christian and Christ is not the head of your life. If that's the case, you're wasting time tonight. But if you love the Lord Jesus Christ, and if you desire the gift that he's giving of eternal life, spiritual life that is prepared and will allow you to live with him in the millennium and also back on earth in New Jerusalem, these things prepare you for life of Christ. These things prepare you to receive your Christian legacy. And that's very, very important. Paul tells us in Ephesians 6, he says, put on the whole armor of God, that in the day of trouble, you'll be able to stand. And in the day of the final analysis, when the devil is hurling darts at you, you will be able to withstand all of the devil's fiery darts. It tells us, take the sword, which is the word of God. Also, have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel. Again, you need God's word there as part of the spiritual armor. And time won't allow me to break down the whole armor, but it's Ephesians chapter 6. You can look at it, verses 10 to 18. It breaks down, if you've never spent time, it breaks down how to put on the armor. It says, start with what? The belt of truth. Bind it around your waist. You see, you have to be truthful when you're dealing with God. It starts with truth. Whose truth? Not your truth. The truth of the Lord Jesus Christ and who he is. Often we think that this gospel is about us. There are many Christians who come to church and they're confused. They think this is about, no, this is not about you. This is about a holy and righteous God who loved you with his compassion and who came some 42 generations down to earth to what? Save you and redeem you. And through his word from heaven, he's able to send it to you to reach you. And through his word, he's able to teach you all things. So that what? You can be covered. You can be who God intended you to be. God says what? You're a chosen people, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood, holy, anointed by God, and set apart for God's use and purpose. That's who you are. And so you have to know who you are this evening, my Christian brothers and sisters, leaders of the church, elder or senior pastor. We must know who we are in God's kingdom. Paul tells us in Romans, he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present what? Your bodies, a living sacrifice, holy, accept the God, which is what? Which is no big thing. It's just your reasonable service. That's where you start. It's starting at first base if you play baseball. And so first base is our spiritual requirement. Let me wrap up this sermon this way, or sermonette, I should say, this way. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, and starting at around verse 12. We'll just do two verses. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12 says this about the word of God. It says, indeed, I'm reading from the NRSV. I need the big print, guys. My vision is failing. So it says the following. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides the spirit from joints and marrow. Let me pause there for a bit. We're going to finish reading it. I don't know if you know anything about sharp instruments, but that's sharp. That God's word is piercing. It can pierce your heart. It can pierce the stoniness of your heart. That's why the psalmist says, create in your God a clean heart and put a new and right spirit within me. And so another prophet says, break up this stony heart and give me a heart of flesh, one which is fertile, where the seed of the word can what? Germinate, take root, and grow. See, because one of the reasons that the psalmist tells us to hide God's word in our heart is so that it can grow within your heart. But let's get back to the sharp sword. It says, it is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And so what does the Bible tell us about the human heart? It says the heart is desperately wicked. And so we love wickedness. We love sin. We love darkness. We love dearth. But Christ is teaching us that it's opposite of all those that are important. Where there's darkness, God loves light. Where there's sin, God loves righteousness. Where there is the desire for trouble, God brings humbleness and humility. God brings the opposite of everything that we love or do as humans. It's the total opposite. That's what Paul says, what? The things which I ought to do, I do not. And the things that I shouldn't do, I do. Because we're prone to sin. And so this word that God has designed to reach us, this word which God says will not come back to me void or empty, that God sits high, he looks low, he records the deeds of men and women. It's a part of your history, your spiritual history, your human history, that the angels are given, and they're going to read out on that resurrection morning and let you know if you've what? Earned eternal life. And if you have, you'll hear these words, well done, the good and faithful servant, enter and enjoy my kingdom. And they'll escort you to heaven for a millennium. Let's finish this. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. And so my Christian brothers and sisters, if you get nothing else from the scripture, that the scripture ought to be an authority in life, remember that the scripture says to us, and Paul reminds the Hebrews here, all of us must render or give an account to God about the things we've done, the kind of life we've lived, whether we've made ourselves available for Jesus, so he may what? Wash us from our sin, cleanse us from all unrighteousness, anoint us and set us apart as a special utensil for his use and glory. And so you better read your word. You better memorize your word. Because if you don't let this word into your life to operate as an authority in your life, you're missing out. You're going to be unprepared for the things that God wants to do with you. And so remember that God's word must have a deep place and a permanent place in your life. In the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Just want to thank Elder Pastor Richardson for such wonderful words that he imparted to us. Thanking God for just being with him as he spoke tonight. And we're coming to a close. Just want to invite you to join us on Sabbath while we worship together in God's temple. If you're not able to join us, you're always welcome to view us on YouTube or YouTube link, FWPCenter. Join us there as well. And now we say goodbye from Wednesday night prayer session or meeting. Hope that you've had a wonderful experience with us. And it's goodbye from us.